Hello, my name is Vicky Heffner, and I'm the Education Curator at the Berks History Center, and I welcome you to our monthly TV program on BCTV. I'm joined today with Trustee Brian Engelhardt, who is also an ambassador for the Berks History Center. He often goes out and talks on various subjects for seniors groups, retirement communities, libraries, and more. So today, Brian Engelhardt is here to talk to us about a very timely subject. But before we start our program on that, I'd like to just invite you to visit the Berks History Center. We're open Wednesday through Saturday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. We still ask that you make appointments for our research library, but please do come to the Berks History Center real soon. We also have our second Saturday series as well as other special events. So Brian, why is this subject so timely, the 1st of November?
The problems that women jurors had, women only began to serve on juries about in Pennsylvania, about the time the 19th Amendment was passed, 1920. And guess what? It's voting time, unless you've done it by mail already, like me. So the jury question was tied into the voting question, and that's one of the things we'll talk about, is did the passage of the 19th Amendment immediately allow women to serve on juries? And there's some fascinating legal points, which we'll talk about. Not too fascinating, not too legal. And there's other things that were problems for the initial women jurors as well that had nothing to do with the law, nothing to do even with the political system, but had everything to do with the courthouse not having any ladies' rooms at the time and the machinations to get a new courthouse. So I'm going to put my glasses on because that makes me look maybe more intelligent sometimes, although my wife will disagree. We are talking about the difficulties that the women encountered, but let's talk about what was the state of the law of the Constitution right at the time in 1920, and oddly enough, there's a Reading link to this. In 1880, in a Strotter versus West Virginia, Judge William Strong, who practiced law in Reading for 25 years, from 1832 to 1857, and is the subject of a historical marker, wrote an opinion where the West Virginia statute provided that black men were not permitted to serve on juries. That went up to the Supreme Court as violating the 14th Amendment, the relatively newly passed 14th Amendment, for equal protection, and Judge Strong wrote, yes, barring people on the basis of race is indeed a violation of the 14th Amendment. But then Judge Strong went on and said, but you know what, as long as you're going to be barring people, he said, you can bar people based on sex, that's okay. Judge, what did you do that for? And add some other ones, but he said the 14th Amendment was never intended to prohibit barring people from juries based on sex. So that left us with an issue to be addressed. There were states, as of 1920, that had already allowed women to serve on juries by their own individual state laws, one of which was not Pennsylvania. There were, 12 of them. And on your screen, you can see women preparing to be registered as jurors in Portland, Oregon. They all look serious. They all have big hats, because that's what you did back then. And they were ready to do their duties as citizens in Portland. But those were forerunners of progress. There were some stereotypes that had to be addressed. One of them was women jurors, or women criminals, if they were good looking, would never be convicted by a male jury. In the upper right-hand corner of the cartoon there, the one lawyer is whispering to another, you can't get a jury to convict a good-looking woman. And the foreman of the jury is saying, we find the defendant not guilty. So, and the how an attractive murderess affects a jury of men is the caption there. Another stereotype was women jurors, if a defendant was good looking, would never acquit them. And the attorney's chit-chat of the upper right hand, if we had a jury of men, we'd never get her off. We would have gotten her off, even if she's guilty. And that's the caption. And the woman says, the foreman of the jury or the foreperson says, we find the defendant guilty, and the good-looking woman looks rather distraught. So that's the stereotype. Charles Gibson is famous because of his artistry. He was an American artist around the turn of the century. And the phrase Gibson girls were basically the women that he painted or sketched at that time. He was sympathetic to women's rights, including the rights of women to serve on juries. And had a number of sketches. This one called The Jury of the Future, Tempering Justice with Mercy. I guess men were just, women were merciful. That was the stereotype at the time. And you can look and see the people are portrayed as intense, focused, intelligent, and he sees this as a, he saw this as something that to look forward to. And notice the Gibson hats. Everybody in Gibson's sketches, women always had flourishing hats. Let's talk about the 19th Amendment. Let's talk some law. I'm a retired attorney. The 19th Amendment provided the right of citizens of the United States to vote shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. Congress shall have the power to enforce this article by appropriate legislation. Okay. Now, how did the Constitution end up getting amended? It all started out in Seneca Falls, New York, where in July of 1848, the Seneca Falls Convention was held, which was the beginnings of the women's suffrage movement. And that movement came to its culmination. The way the Constitution was amended was Congress had to pass it by 3/4, which they did in May of 1919. Then the Senate had to pass it by 3/4, which they did in June of 1919. And then 75% of the states, there was 48 states at the time, needed to ratify and they needed 36. Number 36 was Tennessee. And there was just a little bit of drama at the end where State Senator Colby in Tennessee said, well, maybe I'm going to change my mind. And, well, ultimately he didn't change his mind. Tennessee ratified it, and it became, August 1920, it became part of the Constitution. And we see here the beginning of the phrase suffrage shock in the Reading Times headline that announced that this was going to be implemented. So let's talk about what happened after it was passed. What does suffrage mean? If you look in the Cambridge English Dictionary, it says the right to vote in an election, especially to vote for representatives in government. Some states said, well, it meant other rights as well, like jury service. Pennsylvania was one of them. In the headline in the Reading paper, the Reading Times, it said, women may serve on juries. Well, not so fast. We'll talk about that in a second. Suffrage shock here was an article. The paper said, the Eagle had an, or the Times, I'm sorry, had an article that said that there's suffrage shock because they weren't prepared. It's August. They're going to have an election in November. You'd got to double the electorate. And they're not, 70 years, women have been coming, this has been coming. You've heard the thunder, you knew the rain clouds were overhead, but he never got an umbrella. But they had to register these voters, and there was some poll taxing that was done back in that time. They had to get that done too, some housekeeping. So the county leaders were a bit asleep at the switch. As I said, not so fast. In Erie and Schuylkill and McKean counties, there were court cases that regarding women serving on juries, where women were on juries. In Erie County, a woman on a grand jury, the defendant of this grand jury proceeding, happened to be the mayor of Erie, who was charged with bribery. And the grand jury said, yep, we're binding it over. We're binding it over. He should be charged and tried with bribery. The mayor took this to the court in Erie, and the court in Erie said, not so. There's a woman on the jury, and just because the 19th Amendment was passed, that's all about voting. That's not about women serving on juries. And there was other opinions in Schuylkill and McKean County. It went to the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania. And what did the Supreme Court say in 1921 in Commonwealth versus Maxwell, for you folks keeping score at home? It said, the grand jury verdict is valid where the woman was a member of the panel. That case was on its way to the United States Supreme Court, where there was going to be more delay and more unsurety, until out of Wayne County came Wallace J. Barnes. Yes, Wallace J. Barnes, who pushed through the Barnes Act, which not only gave women in Pennsylvania the right to serve on juries, it also provided that those women had the right to have separate accommodations, to be comfortable. They had things like, aside from lavatories, vanities, sofas, places to lie down, and all the other things that women jurors supposedly would need. So that was the Barnes Act. And away we went in Pennsylvania, and that was effective as of January 1st, 1922. Some other issues arose nationally as women went on jurors. Here's there was an article in the Reading paper. In Ohio, women were upset because apparently at the jury box, they put the women in the front row, and the lawyers would be checking out the ankles of those people in the front row. And so there's a picture of the judge there, said, no, we're going to put a modesty panel there. And the Reading Times, so as to let its readers know what ankles looked like, put somebody in a picture in the paper of one of the people that were sitting in the front row without a modesty panel. So there you go. They did have their readers to look after. So while the rest of the Pennsylvania is moving ahead, Reading had its wonderful courthouse. Look at that. It was where the courthouse is now. Great pillars, a statue on top. It was built in 1840. It sure looked courthouse-ish, didn't it? Three stories. The statues, just to talk some history here. Statue number one is in the Berks History Center. In the lobby, that was there from 1840 to 1879. Statue number two replaced that in 1879, and that is in the Berks County annex to the original courthouse, so you can gaze upon that too. There were problems in the courthouse. It was built in 1840. It was old. It was made of wood. So there was fire hazards concerns. There was no room in the courthouse for prisoners to meet with their lawyers. As a matter of fact, there was nowhere to hold prisoners. So on the sides of courtrooms, they had waiting cells for prisoners. They had no elevators. And there was a major, major, major deficiency. There were no bathrooms for women. I guess in 1840, women had stronger bladders. But that was not designed with a courthouse. In 1840, there were women involved as defendants, plaintiffs, witnesses, and eventually, as the workforce changed, secretaries, caseworkers, and clerks, so that ultimately, the district attorney's office in 1920, Robert Mays, the newly elected district attorney, moved his office to the Berks Trust building so the women on his staff would have accommodations. The county engineer, Charles Sanders, did it, the same thing within a year, and several other offices with social services did that. Consequently, the commissioners at the time, now they had to pay rent for these offices, aside from the fact that, first off, you should have restrooms for women. Second off, now the Barnes Act says you got to have accommodations for women on juries. So that doubles it. They're doubling down with getting. And then finally, they're paying rent. So, but note that there was no women attorneys in Berks County in 1920. But in 1922, Anna Dickinson, we're going to digress for just a second, is admitted to the bar. Anna Dickinson graduated from Reading Girls High School and went right to law school at Dickinson. You didn't have to go to college to become a lawyer back then. In 2 years, after 2 years at Dickinson Law School, the young Anna Dickinson took the bar. Her father was a prominent attorney, and when Anna was brought down, her father supposedly said, "I see the first woman lawyer in Berks County," brought down as an infant. "I see possibly the first woman lawyer in Berks County," is the story the family always told. So Anna got highest grade. She was the youngest attorney ever admitted to the bar, aside from being the first woman. Just a couple things. The Reading Eagle printed the story announcing Anna being admitted to the bar said, her hair was bobbed, and she had a nice dress on, and she did not wear a hat. Nobody that was admitted to the bar had their hair or their attire reported back then, but Anna did because she was a woman. However, the Reading Times pointed out her flying colors with her grades, and that she was the youngest attorney ever admitted to the bar. So hats off to the Reading Times. The Eagle called it girl lawyer. The Times said woman lawyer. Anna passed away in 1982. She had a very low-key legal career, and her last position was as the county law librarian. Although most women that were admitted to the bar after Anna didn't happen until the 60s and the 70s, Anna would regularly advise young women and encourage them about practicing in law. In 1927, every few years, the Bar Association would have a composite. All the members were in the composite. They all would always look stern and look into the camera sternly. Not Anna. She was happy that she was a lawyer, and God bless her. So hats off to Anna. Now we'll go back, but she was indeed and a remarkable woman and a true pioneer in the profession. The Reading Times and Reading Eagle both spoke up and said, "Hey, you know, now women can be in the jury wheel in 1922. Are you ready, commissioners? Are you going to do it? We should do that." And what did they do? No, they didn't. The papers blasted them. They said, this is nothing more than a sign of local prejudice and dragging your feet for something that's a legal requirement. And so those editorials finally got the commissioners to move ahead, and the women were drawn as jurors at the end of 1922 to serve in the 1923 term. 24 women jurors were drawn. The first woman drawn was uh, let's see. Oh, yes. Anna Posey. Much to the credit of the papers, they listed her name as Anna Posey. They did not list her name as Mrs. E.B. Posey. Her husband, E.B. Posey, was a prominent Republican assemblyman. But among the other women drawn for jury service was a stenographer, teacher, a number of housewives, and away they went. On coroner's juries in 1920, which are a side thing, women began to serve right away. No fuss, no muss. And that's what happened. So the commissioners at the time, faced with getting these accommodations ready for women, were Walter Ringler was the chairman. Francis Savage was, he was a Democrat. Francis Savage, also a Democrat, was in the majority. And the minority commissioner was John Blimlein, who nobody ever listened to because he was in the minority. That's just the way it worked back then. Women in the first months did encounter problems. Late trials and involved questions where if the jurors had to stay overnight, where would the women stay? Where would the women on the jury stay? And they had a couple of meetings. The League of Women Voters came and had the commissioners together and brought in some lawyers and other women to see what was going to happen, to explain to them what happens when you serve on a jury, what the court proceedings are about, why they're asking questions, who's responsible for what. And the commissioner said, yep, we're going to make things happen. We'll make things happen that are good. Well, they didn't. And so Mary Archer, who was the president of the League of Women Voters, said she called the commissioners again and said, let's get together. Mary Archer was an advocate for animals' rights, prisoners' rights, women's rights, political rights, and was the first woman Democrat to the Democratic Convention, a woman delegate to the Democratic Convention. Finally, year after year, the commissioners dithered. Every year they would say, yeah, we got to do something. 1924, 25, 26, 27, 28. They said, yep, we got to do something about this courthouse. In the meanwhile, Toon and Janssen, Ferdinand Toon and Henry Janssen, had a movement to have Reading annex part of West Reading. They even bought part of West Reading in order to have the courthouse built there. And there's a map, and the model of the model courthouse was going to be right across the Penn Street Bridge, you know, on what was called Line Box Hill. There was a lot of confusing issues about it. This is a lovely cartoon that was in the Reading Times and about all the issues involved. Ultimately, the Reading Times had a poll. Where do you want the courthouse to be? And they had several sites, one of Line Box Hill, one of the courthouse where it is now. 50,000 people voted. 30,000 said where it is now. 15,000 said Line Box Hill. The commissioner said, hooray, the people have voted. And they got moving on the courthouse. In 1931, the old courthouse was demolished. It was, the movements were moved to a warehouse at 4th and Cork Streets, where presumably there were accommodations for women. And in 1932, December 32, the new courthouse was dedicated. Hallelujah. The cartoon in the paper is the new courthouse looking at the old, old courthouse that was at Penn Square saying, I don't look like the same person, do I? So just a side note, women were not on federal juries until 1957. There were 30 more states that trickled in getting women on juries after Pennsylvania allowed women on juries. So it was not an instant process. The last three states, for you keeping score at home, Alabama, South Carolina, and Mississippi. What a surprise. So finally, women achieved equality, the same equality as men, which is to try to avoid jury duty. But they wanted to avoid it while they had proper accommodations. Kevin Crosby, an English political scientist said, there's probably always more people, women and men, seeking to avoid jury service than were people trying to serve on the jury. But it's the principle of the thing, right, Vicky?
It is.
It is. So, so that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Any questions?
No, I had seen this program before, Brian, as you mentioned.
I'm a rerun then.
The Judge Strong robe, his robe is in the collection of the Historical Society of Berks County. And that was mentioned in the beginning of the program. But thank you very much. Brian initially developed this program for the Berks History Conference, which was to be the 100th anniversary of women gaining the right to vote. And that was right around the time that COVID hit. So unfortunately, Brian was not able to do it then, but he has since presented otherwise for the Berks History Center and for seniors groups, retirement communities. You can reach out to me at the Berks History Center if you'd like to schedule Brian for a program for your group. I thank you for joining Brian and I today, and thank you, Brian, very much for your presentation. Thank you.
Thanks. I do historical societies, civic organizations, baseball groups. I do them all. Anybody that wants to listen to a little history, and there's some funniness in there as well, some humor. Thank you.
Thank you.